Well, thanks so much to the organizers of the meeting for allowing me to moderate this session and start our discussion with this review of treating H. pylori infection in 2016. Realize that the American College has just finished an update of its treatment guideline for H. pylori infection. It's undergoing some finishing touches with the Board of Trustees, and we hope that this document will be published early in 2017. So realize that all of this will ultimately be findable in that document. All right, so let's start off with a case. This case is a 38-year-old Russian man who presents with recurrent epigastric pain, which occurs after meals and sometimes awakens him at night. He was born in Moscow but lived in the United States in his 20s, or moved to the United States in his 20s. His symptoms have been escalating for the past 12 months. He reports mild nausea but no vomiting, and he's lost 6 pounds because of his symptoms. His mother has a history of quote-unquote ulcers, and his physical examination is otherwise normal. Because he has warning signs, that is, escalating symptoms as well as the weight loss, an upper endoscopy is done, and it discloses a 1.2-centimeter duodenal ulcer. Gastric histology is positive for H. pylori infection, and the patient's treated with triple therapy. Now, if you had a patient like this, raise your hand if you would have chosen triple therapy. And by the way, there's no absolute right or wrong. I'm just really want to get a sampling for what people are doing. And this very much reflects what I would have expected, which is the vast majority of doctors, gastroenterologists in the United States, are still using triple therapy. And we'll talk about the merits and possible detractors associated with that in the next few minutes. A urea breath test performed 4 weeks after the completion of this triple therapy actually turns out to be positive for persistent infection. And that's something that I think we're all dealing with increasingly in our own practices, is that the primary care docs are dealing with primary H. pylori infection. What we're left with is really the aftermath of failed therapy, or patients who are incidentally discovered to be infected at the time of endoscopy, treated, and then turn out to have persistent infection. So we'll talk about that as well. So first thing, this is the current treatment paradigm, as evidenced by the responses from the people in the audience. I think that standard first-line therapy in the United States remains triple therapy, the combination of a proton pump inhibitor, clarithromycin, and amoxicillin. And in general, we tend to reserve bismuth quadruple therapy, so PPI, bismuth, tetracycline, metronidazole, for situations where there's persistent H. pylori infection despite an initial attempt at treatment. Well, I think some people are also using levofloxacin triple therapy. We'll talk about that as well. But this is the current treatment paradigm. And I think that going forward, we really need to critically reassess whether this is the right or wrong thing to do as time passes and as things change in regards to the epidemiology and resistance patterns amongst H. pylori isolates from the United States and indeed the world. All right, so let's start at the beginning. We're going to talk first about first-line therapy, and then we're going to close this talk with a discussion about the situation that was presented in the case, a patient with persistent infection. So first thing is, these are going to be the recommended therapies for first-line treatment of H. pylori infection in the upcoming management guideline that will be published in the Red Journal in the next several months. So clarithromycin triple therapy will remain a recommended therapy in certain specific situations. We'll touch on that in just a moment. But bismuth quadruple therapy should increasingly be on your radar screen as a viable first-line treatment alternative for patients with H. pylori infection. And we'll talk about why that's the case in just a moment. And then also something that I think is not very widely used in the United States, but that we're recommending in the new guideline, concomitant therapy. So this is also quadruple therapy, but it consists of a proton pump inhibitor, clarithromycin, amoxicillin, and metronidazole. So this is a clarithromycin-based four-drug treatment regimen that offers relatively high rates of eradication in individuals with this infection. By the way, if we go back to that slide for just a moment, I want to note the durations of therapy. You should not be using, in my opinion, if you're using clarithromycin triple therapy, you should not be using that for less than 14 days duration. For bismuth quadruple therapy, as well as concomitant therapy, we're going to recommend 10 to 14 days duration. And I want to give you some idea about what's been happening in the United States over time in regards to the effectiveness of triple therapy for H. pylori infection. There's very little longitudinal data in regards to the effectiveness of this therapy in the United States. This is actually data that we're presenting at this meeting over the next couple of days. It's a 15-year experience with triple therapy at the University of Michigan, around 700 patients in this database. And what you can see is that the overall eradication rate is somewhere around 78-79%, and that it's remained actually quite stable over the course of the past 15 years. You could argue that maybe it's gone down a little bit, but certainly not statistically significantly so. So what are the take-home messages from this analysis? First thing is that the eradication rates with this therapy appear to be relatively stable. Maybe if they've gone down, have gone down only a little bit. But here's the important take-home message for all of you. The eradication rate with triple therapy is less than 80%. That means, from a pragmatic standpoint, that somewhere between 1 in 4 and 1 in 5 individuals that you treat with this therapy is not going to be or are not going to be successfully eradicated of their infection. And this is one of the main reasons why we've taken a step back and we've said, is this really the right thing to be primarily treating everybody with H. pylori infection in the United States with triple therapy? Now, there are, and I think increasingly we should be focusing on four drug regimens. So either bismuth quadruple therapy or concomitant therapy. Now, to give you some idea about the relative efficacy of these different first-line H. pylori therapies, this is data from that's combined from two recent meta-analyses that have been published in peer-reviewed literature, actually very high citation journals. And you can see that, once again, in this meta-analysis, the triple therapy yields an eradication rate of less than 80%. So a significant proportion of individuals will not be successfully eradicated of their infection with triple therapy. You can see that with bismuth quadruple therapy, in this international meta-analysis, the eradication rate was around 85%. And with concomitant therapy, it approached 90%. Okay, so again, we should be I think a critically important thing to remember is that your best chance to eradicate H. pylori infection comes with the first attempt you make to treat the infection. Every subsequent trial or attempt to try to get rid of the infection becomes increasingly more difficult. So choosing the right therapy coming out of the box is critically important. There are other therapies that we talk about in the guideline and for which there is evidence, but just not necessarily very good U.S. evidence. So hybrid therapy, which is a combination of a proton pump inhibitor and amoxicillin followed by a four-drug regimen. Levofloxacin triple therapy, which I think many of you are familiar with, is a salvage regimen. Actually, turns out it's been tested in quite a few international studies as a first-line therapy and is also effective in that vein as well. Levofloxacin sequential therapy. So this is a takeoff on the idea of using levofloxacin in a sequential regimen, which is listed up here. And in a small number of studies conducted, again, outside the United States, this therapy has proven very effective. And one therapy that's been tested in just one trial, but it was from the United States, so-called load therapy. So levofloxacin, a proton pump inhibitor, doxycycline, as well as nitazoxanide, has also been shown to be effective in one RCT from the United States. But I think if you stick to those first three regimens that I talked about, that would be a good way to go. Now, this is the only recent data on antimicrobial resistance from the United States. This is from the Houston VA, David Graham's group, who published a fairly good-sized series on antimicrobial resistance rates amongst their population of veterans. And you can see that the metronidazole resistance rate is actually lower than has been widely reported in previous reports. But the clarithromycin resistance rate is about the same or a little bit higher at 16%. Levofloxacin resistance was surprisingly high in this series. 31% of isolates from this single center series from the Houston VA actually had levofloxacin resistance amongst their H. pylori isolates. Tetracycline, amoxicillin, essentially there is no resistance. Now, I show this to make this point, and those of you that have heard me speak about this before have heard me say this, but I want to emphasize this again. It's very important to think about what antibiotics an individual has been exposed to when making a choice of therapy for H. pylori infection, specifically as it pertains to macrolides and quinolones. In regards to first-line therapy, because triple therapy is so widely used still to this day in the United States, I would say this: you should always be asking about whether somebody has received previous macrolide therapy. The reason for that is depicted on this slide and also this slide. Bottom line, the greater the number of exposures, previous exposures to a macrolide for any reason, the greater the likelihood that an individual will have a macrolide-resistant strain of H. pylori. Therefore, if you ask a person if they previously received macrolides for any reason, they should not be treated with triple therapy. This is a critically, critically important point. You're always going to ask about whether somebody is allergic to penicillin. That's a no-brainer. But you should also be asking about previous macrolide exposure. If there's a history of previous macrolide exposure for any reason, you should not be using triple therapy. So here is a general construct that literally I practice by every day. This will be a variation of this will be in the guideline. I think it provides a fairly simple construct to think about how to choose therapy in the first line setting. So ask about penicillin allergy, ask about previous macrolide exposure. If there is no history of penicillin allergy or macrolide exposure, you can choose any of those therapies that I talked about. Either you can choose traditional triple therapy, concomitant therapy, bismuth quadruple therapy. If there is a history of no penicillin allergy but previous macrolide exposure, triple therapy drops off the list. You should not be using triple therapy. If you have a history of penicillin allergy with no previous macrolide exposure, bismuth quadruple therapy, and then finally, penicillin allergy and previous macrolide exposure, bismuth quadruple therapy. So you can see how bismuth quadruple therapy is percolating up in terms of one of the primary therapies that we should be thinking about using in the first line setting for H. pylori infection. So a couple statements about post-treatment testing. This is what the guideline is going to say, barring any further revisions. Whenever H. pylori infection is identified and treated, testing to prove eradication should be performed using a urea breath test, fecal antigen test, or biopsy-based testing at least 4 weeks after the completion of antibiotic therapy and after PPI therapy has been withheld for at least 1 and preferably 2 weeks. There may be infrequent situations in which eradication testing is impractical or unnecessary, and I think we can all think of such situations. But in general, the way the committee came down on this was if you're interested enough to try to diagnose the infection, you're interested enough to give multiple antibiotics to try to get rid of it, you should be interested enough to find out whether the infection is gone or not. So again, either a urea breath test or a fecal antigen test or a biopsy-based test, either histology is really preferable in the post-treatment setting. Any of those things can be successfully used to identify successful eradication or persistent H. pylori infection. So let's spend the balance of our time now talking about salvage therapy for patients with persistent infection as our case illustrated. So some general rules. First thing, don't use the same antibiotics. I think in general, gastroenterologists are all on the same page about this, but I'll tell you, our primary care colleagues, this message has not percolated down. I still frequently see patients that have been treated with triple therapy 2, sometimes even 3 times. So please make sure to share that information with your primary care colleagues. Stress the importance of compliance and review possible side effects. Patients are much more likely to stay compliant with, for example, bismuth quadruple therapy if they know that it will make their tongue black and it can change the color and consistency of their stool. If you inform them about that, they won't be scared and they won't stop therapy. Okay, that's really important. Treat for 10 to 14 days. Use high dose or use PPI BID, and some would argue that you should actually use high dose PPI BID in the salvage setting. And consider culture and sensitivity testing after 2 failed attempts with empiric therapy. And this is not evidence-based. This is a recommendation that really started from the European guideline, but many other guidelines have picked up, including ours. You know, one of the big problems for us, of course, in the United States is that culture and sensitivity testing is not widely accessible. So where this actually fits in and how it fits into your practice is really dictated by your local availability or lack thereof of this kind of testing. All right, so depicted on this slide are a variety of different therapies that could be considered in the salvage setting. And again, I'm going to give you a very simple construct to put this into context at the very end. So, and you'll notice, by the way, that a lot of these therapies look the same. So bismuth quadruple therapy is sort of the tried and true salvage regimen for persistent infection. Levofloxacin triple therapy, again, I think we're all very used to using these. Concomitant therapy, and we'll talk about where that might fit into this treatment paradigm. Rifabutine triple therapy, and this is an interesting therapy, not only because there's reasonably good efficacy data for using this as a salvage therapy, but also because there are products in development that might be coming to the United States. And then finally, high-dose dual therapy, the combination of frequent high-dose PPI combined with high-dose amoxicillin has also been used as a salvage regimen. You can see that in general, salvage treatments should be given for 14 days. So this is what the guideline's going to say in terms of the practical application of all that treatment regimen information I just showed you. If an individual was initially treated with triple therapy containing clarithromycin, okay, which is what most everybody in the audience would have chosen, bismuth quadruple therapy, or levofloxacin, or a levofloxacin-containing regimen like levofloxacin triple therapy is going to be your choice. On the other hand, if somebody initially got bismuth quadruple therapy, thinking about concomitant therapy or a levofloxacin-based salvage therapy is going to be the way to go. Okay, and so a lot of different regimens I showed you, but it really boils down to a fairly simple construct. In the guideline, there will be this flowchart that I think it's not a bad idea to copy this, put it up on your wall in your clinic. But this really breaks it down in terms of penicillin allergy. Well, actually, it breaks it down on the basis of what initial regimen an individual got. So if they initially got a clarithromycin containing regimen, thinking about previous quinolone exposure as well as penicillin allergy and making choices based upon that. And it really boils down to what I told you on that last slide. Or if an individual got an initial course of bismuth quadruple therapy, again, breaking down and choosing options based upon that information. So the key take-home points. The key factors to consider when choosing primary therapy for H. pylori infection include the presence or absence of penicillin allergy, local antibiotic resistance rates, if you're lucky enough to have that information available to you. Unfortunately, almost all of us do not have that information in the United States. Previous macrolide exposure, and I would actually say that previous quinolone exposure as well, you should be thinking about if you're thinking about choosing a quinolone-containing regimen. Quadruple therapies are replacing traditional triple therapies, and I think increasingly in your own practice, you should be thinking about converting to four-drug regimens as first-line therapy for H. pylori infection. Key factors to consider when choosing salvage therapy: avoid the drugs that have previously been used, treat for 14 days. Quadruple therapies and levofloxacin-based therapies are preferred. High-dose PPI and amoxicillin, as well as rifabutine-based triple therapy, are other evidence-based treatment options, not necessarily from the United States, but there certainly is literature from other parts of the world. So thank you very much for your attention.